welcome to Christ Episcopal Church in Red Wing, Minnesota, on this last Sunday after the Epiphany. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The first lesson is a reading from the book of 2 Kings. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, as the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry land. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you. Elisha said, please let me inherit a double share of your spirit. He responded, you have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken away from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not. As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended into a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen. But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 50. The Lord, the God of gods, has spoken. He has called the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, perfect in its beauty, God reveals himself in glory. Our God will come and will not keep silence. Before him there is a consuming flame, and round about him a raging storm. He calls the heavens and the earth from above to witness the judgment of his people. Gather before me, my loyal followers, those who have made a covenant with me and sealed it with sacrifice. Let the heavens declare the righteousness of his cause, for God himself is judge. The second lesson today is a reading from the book of 2 Corinthians. Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of Jesus Christ according to Mark. Six days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So this is the last Sunday after Epiphany, which means that we are entering into Lent. And it's this last Sunday after Epiphany that we hear this story of the Transfiguration. When Jesus takes his three prominent disciples, Peter, James, and John, the Zebedee brothers, who also will be going with him to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray the night before he dies. And he takes them up to this mountaintop. And then they have a collective vision. It's as if the veil is pulled apart and they see Jesus Christ in all of his glory. It says that his white garment was ablaze. It was so bright. And there he stood on the top of this mountain talking to Moses and Elijah, these two great prophets from the Old Testament. And then there was the voice out of the cloud that hovered over the top of that mountain, like on Jesus' baptism, that said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him." What a mountaintop experience. And I wonder how it transformed those disciples. Now I want to take us back in Mark, just the passage right before this. Jesus told his disciples, his small group, for the first time that he was going to have to suffer, be rejected, be killed, and after 3 days, be raised from the dead. And Peter, in that encounter, pulled Jesus aside and said, "That's not going to happen." He rebuked Jesus. And Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan. You are thinking on human things." And then Jesus launches into his instructions about what it means to follow him, what it means to be a disciple. He says, if you want to follow me, if you want to be my disciple, you need to take up your cross and follow me. And if anyone wants to hold on to their life, they will lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake and the sake of the gospel, the good news, you will find life. Well, Jesus took his disciples on top of this mountain, a mountaintop experience. That's a metaphor for this, right, in our life of having this revelation of this blissful experience. And I want to say, in contrast, I think rather than mountaintop experiences, friends, I think we've been having dark valley experiences. And I think both mountaintop and dark valley experiences have a lot to teach us. We are at 11 months of this pandemic. 11 months, almost a year. I don't think any of us could have imagined what we were heading into back in March. I've heard from so many people say, one of the things that I've realized is how much I miss the small things. How much I miss hugging my grandchildren or being with family on holidays or seeing my friends for coffee, sitting over a cup of coffee in a restaurant. I heard a young person say last fall when the sports programs were shut down, he said, I can't believe how much I miss sports. He said, and I guess I just took it for granted. And another young person said, and I really miss being in school, being with my teachers right there. I learned so much more. And seeing my friends. And people who've been furloughed or laid off. What an impact this pandemic has had on their life, the lessons they've learned, things we've taken for granted, our health, our relationships, going to church on Sunday, right? And I wonder, what are the lessons we're going to take away with us? What's going to last? How will this have changed us, transformed us? Just as on that mountaintop, the veil was pulled aside and the disciples saw something they had never seen before, Jesus in all his glory. I think in this valley place, the veil is pulled away and we're seeing some of the harsh realities of our life, as well as those lessons we'll take with us. I think that we've heard this on the news over and over again, that some of those who are most impacted in the United States by this pandemic are people of color. And just recently, they've been coming out with the data on that. Indigenous people, American Indians, 1 out of 750 indigenous people have died from COVID. 1 out of 800 African Americans have died from COVID. And the statistic for whites is 1 out of 1,325. Still far too many, far too many. But far less than people of color. And we know that what underlies that is poverty, systemic racism. They don't have access, as good as access, to health care. This pandemic, as the veil is pulled away, we're learning things. If we didn't know them before, we're hearing and learning and seeing things. And I wonder, how will it change us? How will it change us once we know and we've seen? And it's not just this pandemic, right? This is not the only valley that we've been in. We've had numerous valleys. We've had the killing of George Floyd right up 61 in my city where I live. George Floyd was killed. And then there were wildfires and hurricanes, unprecedented, the earth crying out, help, we've got to do something about climate change. And then just last month, the assault on the Capitol, something that I think was unimaginable to us, the deep, deep divide between us in our country, the fragility of our democracy, that in that moment it could have turned out very differently. And 50 police officers were injured and one lost his life. And what I saw there was something that was so disturbing to me, that this veil was moved aside, and what I saw was the cross on the ellipse outside the White House and a gallows. And then inside the Capitol building, what I saw were rioters, the mob had both flags that said Jesus saves and the Confederate flag. I think that moment was like a veil being pulled aside, and we saw into the deep division of our nation. So what do we do with this? Jesus says, take up your cross and follow me. If you want to be my disciples, you need to be willing to sacrifice, to give up your life, not just live for yourself, but to live for Christ, the sake of the gospel. And what is that gospel? Our presiding bishop, Michael Curry, says, the essence of the gospel of Jesus Christ is loving, is liberating, and is life-giving. That's the good news. And we as followers of Jesus are called by our Savior, by our Lord who is on that mountaintop, who is on that cross, who died for us, who says, if you want to be my disciples, it's not just go to church on Sundays. It's, are you willing to take up your cross? Are you willing to lose your life for this good news? To set people free? To love people who, in our human, natural way of being, might think that they're unlovable and they're our enemies? How do we bridge these divides? How do we bring people in to the beloved community that God desires for all creation? My hope is we're going to be on the other side of this pandemic. But some of these other issues are deep. They're deep. And there's not a quick vaccine for them. It's going to take hard work of many of us, including people of faith. This is not outside of what we're called to do in our discipleship of Jesus, because helping to set people free is what we're called to do. So after this mountaintop experience, Peter was sitting outside of Pilate's palace when Jesus was being tried and rejected and condemned to death. And Peter, blessed Peter, denied Jesus three times. He had seen Christ in his glory, and he still screwed up. And Jesus still forgave him. We are not going to be perfect in our walk of discipleship. We can't do this work of setting people free, of dealing with some of the issues of systemic racism alone. We do it with God, we do it with partners, we do it with other people of faith, people of other faiths. But where it starts is here, is a transformation of our hearts, of our minds, opening up, seeking the Spirit to give us the courage to do the hard work that we're being called to do in our generation and in our time, and not just let that veil slip back and be about our comfortable lives. If you want to be my disciple, said Jesus, take up your cross and follow me. Amen.
Prayers of the people. Jesus began his public ministry when he was baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist. We pray that we, as a baptized community of faith, may minister to others in the way that Jesus taught us. Say, God of light, hear our prayer. Caring God, we thank you for your gifts in creation, for the church, for our world, for our land, for its beauty and resources, for the sunshine and for the rain, for the cold and for the snow. We are grateful for the rich heritage we enjoy. We thank you for the researchers and scientists who have developed a vaccine that might end this pandemic. God of light, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are leaders in the nations of the world. Give them peace, understanding, and compassion for their people. And for this nation where we live, help us all to reach out in love to one another, to love one another. Instill in everyone a sense of justice, love, and caring. God of light, hear our prayer. Awesome God, we thank you for giving us life and for the days we have enjoyed on this earth. We thank you for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for all those who make this community of Red Wing a special place to live. God of light, hear our prayer. We pray for all those persons who, through their own or others' actions, are deprived of the fullness of life, for the prisoners, refugees, the handicapped, the homeless, the unemployed, and all those who are still having to deal with COVID-19. God of light, hear our prayer. Creator God, we give you thanks for all those who have gone before us to enter your promised eternal kingdom. We truly miss each of them. But we know that they are now enjoying your loving embrace, and we know that they are one with all your saints. God of light, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
You do it.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved our neighbor. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. God's peace. God's peace. Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time you sent your only Son to be a light to the nations. He is the Word made flesh who lives among us. He was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist. To the poor he proclaimed good news, to prisoners freedom, to the sorrowful joy, and to the sick wholeness. And to fulfill your purposes on earth, he gave himself up to death. And rising from the grave, he overcame sin and death and promises to make the whole creation new through his just and gracious rule. We read from John's Gospel. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Loving them and knowing what was ahead, Jesus washed their feet and then broke bread with them. We can imagine him at that table looking around at his friends, who were confused and distressed. They had moved through the traditional Passover meal, and then Jesus took bread and said, "This is my body given for you. When you do this, remember me." And he filled a cup of wine, saying, "This cup is a new way of being, a new promise, sealed in my blood. When you drink this cup, remember me." We sit at that table with Christ, with our own confusions, concerns, longings, fears, and pains. We reach out our hands to receive and invite Christ to feed us with what we need most. And there with Christ at that table, we invite the Spirit to fill us. We put our hands over our hearts, and we know our own emptiness. And then we ask for the fullness of the Holy Spirit to give us courage, faith, hope, and love. And together we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please join me in praying. Jesus Christ, you revealed yourself to the world so that all people might look to you and be saved. May we know the wholeness that you bring. Be our light in the darkness, that we may not stumble, and lift us up again if we fall. All this we ask in your name. Amen. And God's blessing be with you. Christ's peace be with you, and the Spirit's outpouring be with you, now and forever. Amen.
Alleluia, alleluia. Let us go forth in peace carrying boldly our cross for Christ. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.